everyone, this is Ginger Balch from In Sheep's Clothing in Torrington, welcoming you to another episode of Focus on Fiber. Today I'm so happy to welcome back Andra, sales rep for Barocco Yarns, as well as others. Today Andra is here to discuss and demonstrate stranding over garter stitch. I would have my needles ready, but I don't anymore.
I have needles.
You have them for us. How are you, Andra?
Thank you for having me back, Ginger. It's so happy to be here.
Oh, it's a pleasure to have you here. So I understand that you got back just a little while back ago about Stitches.
Stitches. Yes, I got to attend Stitches Midwest again, and it was a wonderful show this year. It's always lovely to be in a room full of women happy to buy yarn and be around yarn and see what's knitting.
Nothing better.
Yeah, enjoy it very, very much.
And it was a big, successful show.
Yes, it was. These have, I'd say, between 5,000 and 6,000 knitters come from all over the Chicago metro area, and some come in from farther away to take classes and spend the weekend with their friends and knit, learn things, and buy yarn and see samples.
Mm-hmm. And you have a bunch of samples here to show us.
Yes, I do.
Of some of the really super, I'm imagining that this was a very popular piece in the show.
Yes, it was on purpose. So when I'm selecting things for the show, it's interesting. About 80% of knitters really enjoy the simple knits, garter stitch or things we can watch Game of Thrones or Netflix or watch whatever PBS shows are on, Downton Abbey, without having to look at a pattern.
Right.
And there's maybe about the other 10 or 20% of knitters that are experienced people that really don't need us. They just need a place to find a pattern or find the yarn.
Right.
But the bulk of them want something inspiring that looks like it was rather complicated to impress their friends and family, but they can knit happily while they're killing time a little bit at a softball game or at a swim meet or during Netflix or other videos that they want to work on.
Right.
Something simple. So when I choose the garments, I try to choose things that fit that criteria that will be that are eye-catching. They have curb appeal. They're very simple, but they look like you did a little bit more work than you did, because that's what it's all about.
Right. And so many knitters, myself included, just don't have that much time.
Yes.
To do these major projects, and you have something that has so much impact.
Exactly, with very little effort.
Yes.
Very little effort. And I can pick it up and not have to study instructions to find where was I, where did I leave off, what are these notes, and just pick it up for an inning of a baseball game maybe and then put it back down and come back at it next time the socks try again. Again.
Okay.
So what I've brought for you today, the only thing I want to mention too briefly about the Stitches show is the age group.
Oh, okay.
It's interesting. You and I are about the same age, and the new knitters in the past were younger people.
Right.
Now the newer knitters are our age. So looking at the color in someone's hair does not indicate to me their level of expertise,
which is
very unusual for me. I used to be able to tell. So now I have to assume that I'm starting from scratch with somebody, even to the point of knowing that they have to wind down the yarns that are twisted.
Absolutely.
Exactly. So start from scratch with somebody, and they'll let you know if they're more advanced than that and they don't need any kind of guidance. But that's where we are. I guess maybe it's recently retired or and just want to do something interesting, but without having to have a project or learning a new technique or learning a new language or something hard. I just want something to occupy instead.
Right.
So that's the kind of things that I brought to share today that I think look rather impressive, but they have very little skill level involved.
Okay. Well, I'm looking forward to some new things I can bring
back today.
And we have some new projects. Yes.
So when the Barocco design team went together and was putting together collections, they also did the same percentage wise. So 20% of the garments are a little bit harder to knit, and then about 80% of them were simpler, but not necessarily looking simpler.
Right.
And I hit on the Chandra scarves very, very early on this summer, and I wanted to study them more because I found this amazing. When I first saw the original sample of the Chandra scarf that they've done in cream and pink and orange, your viewers can see this under Chandra on Barocco.com or on Ravelry under Chandra. That's Chandra.
Okay.
I looked at it and I thought, oh no, they put weaving in a knitting book. And
that's a good thing.
I was like, please, you put weaving in the knitting book. I know they sneak crochet in occasionally, right. But weaving, really? So I had someone please tell me how it's made. And what this is, you can hold up the piece so your viewers can see. This is actually stranding over one stitch on garter. So let me back that out and explain it in detail. In general, when we're making an Icelandic sweater, you know, with the yokes across the top,
right.
We're stranding. In other words, you're carrying a contrast color in the back and you bring it out every one or three, five, six stitches to make the stars or shapes or design.
Right.
So you're stranding over many stitches and you have a definite right side and wrong side.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, if you flip the other side, well, there is no definite right or wrong side. And the stranding on a sweater is usually in stockinette. In the round, you're knitting mm-hmm. every round and doing two colors. In this case, we have garter stitch every row. They're slipping. It's all knit all the time. I know your head is.
I know. I'm looking at it and I say, oh, it's a slip stitch.
Nope, no slipping here. So
wow.
This is knit. Every stitch of every row is just knit. Don't really need the
pattern.
Okay,
stranding. Okay, I think I just got a glimmer of what's going on. Okay.
So light bulbs.
Okay, yep.
So we're doing one stitch of stranding on garter stitch. So we're knitting every stitches, and in this case, there's only two colors to a row to keep it super easy for the knitter.
Just what I like
too. We don't want any more than that.
Yeah.
Yes, and that sample, I used three colors total to make it have the Burberry style of colorway.
Uh-huh.
So the main color is cream, and then our two contrast colors are tan and black.
Mm-hmm.
So cream is happening all the time.
Okay.
And then there's two rows that have black garter, mm-hmm. and then you drop the black and pick up
and
the tan, and then go two rows, and you carry it up on the edge. And
mm-hmm.
if you notice, the edges are quite lovely.
Yeah.
And I specifically did
neat.
Not fringe this.
Look very neat.
So that we could demonstrate that the edges are lovely enough that this could be a baby blanket or an afghan or one of those vest or sweater wraps that uses all straight edges and rectangles. So you
mm-hmm.
do this stitch on it.
Mm-hmm.
I found that quite fabulous. Now the other trick is that you're doing a checkerboard. So for example, if I'm on the first row that's white, black, white, black, white, black,
mm-hmm.
when I turn around, I come back and I do the opposite of what I see. Black, white, black, white, black, white.
Mm-hmm.
So you're checkerboarding. So that if you, it's 280 stitches, which is tedious to cast on. So if
mm-hmm.
you have one too few or one too many that gives you the odd number, it doesn't matter if the pattern says do color A and then color B. Just do a checkerboard so that it doesn't matter what number of stitches you've cast on. Pick your gauge and then go with it.
Okay.
And yes, you are correct. This is cast on the long way. So here's
right.
my cast on edge. I
right.
do a cabled cast on.
Yeah, that's a beautiful edge.
It's a beautiful edge.
Very
and
nice.
It's the long ways,
same
and yes,
thing.
It's 280 stitches. I did use a 32-inch circular rather than a 24 because that would be a little bit too many stitches to cram onto my 24-inch circular.
Right, right.
And yeah. then when I get to my finish out with the yarn, I did a regular bind off trying to emulate this edge so that from
right.
a distance the edges look like they
yeah.
match.
No, it looks very nice.
Even though it's not exactly. And you know what else is very interesting is I didn't have to cast off with a larger needle because
nice.
The garter stitch with the stranding pulls in a little bit already.
Right.
So you could use the same needle that you're using rather than having to go up to prevent that tight edge.
Sure.
You know how when
sure.
things turn into a hot dog
no,
shape when
nice
they're done.
Yeah, no, it's nice and loose.
Yes. So let me talk a little bit about my color choices. This was...
Mm-hmm.
This was the bulk of my month of May, what I was doing. So when the design department chooses their colors, they have their reasons and they photograph and how things show in pictures and the
mm-hmm.
colors, generally they show the new colors. And when I saw the color that's in the pattern book that your viewers will see when they go to Ravelry and look up Chandra, they'll see a scarf that has very short fringe and that has like I said, cream and pink and orange. And it doesn't have the curb appeal
mm-hmm.
that I wanted my samples to have to go to a consumer show.
Right.
So the colors that the yarn comes in, the yarn is a merino and silk called Bento. And this is the color card for Bento. Can we all see this fine? Is that good?
Oh, yeah.
You
I'll
do
just
that.
Hold it for you.
So Bento... comes in this range of colors, and they've covered the rainbow, but I am probably like your viewers, just How do I pick a color? And I want it to be perfect the first time, because we all want it to be perfect
Right.
the first time.
Right.
So I was trying, and it just plaid's not my thing, because this reminds me of plaid. Mm-hmm. So what I did, I discovered, was if you go to Google and you type in tartan plaid and then click on images, there's a calculator there with color. You can pick two colors and it shows you every tartan plaid that uses those colors.
For knitting? Because I know they do it for weaving.
Plaid. Yeah,
oh,
it's okay. Been much like for weaving, I suspect.
Okay.
So if I put in, for example, I saw it had beige. I thought, what plaid uses beige? So I clicked on beige and black, mm-hmm. and up comes all of these glorious plaids. I'm like, mm-hmm. okay, well, there's one.
Okay.
So I kept clicking through, trying to find pleasing colorways. So I ended up saying to Barocco, send me one ball of every color. This is the beauty of being the sales rep. I didn't have to invest in it.
Very nice, yes.
And it's work product, so it's yes. fine. And honestly, the design department doesn't have the luxury of taking 2 weeks to swatch. And my yarn shop owners, my customers, don't have the time or the luxury
right.
to swatch everything. But I had the time in May, so I took that time. I think I used it wisely.
Uh-huh.
So I got one ball of every color, and then I fired up my Google images of tartan plaids, and I started swatching.
Oh.
So we'll talk about these swatches first.
Nice.
So I basically was clicking on colors, trying to find pleasing colorways that would be striking. I remember, like in any venue, you need something that will be striking from a distance, curb appeal.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So obviously my tan and cream and black was the winner. Obviously, yeah, that's never leaving my side. Never. So I started with, as you can see, some of the reds and pinks, mm-hmm. trying out different colorways and holding them from a distance. You saw on one of my email newsletters, I used a dry rack and then put them far away on the patio and took photographs, because
mm-hmm.
oftentimes then you can get a better feel
right.
for what does this look like from a distance rather than in your lap, because
right.
in your lap it's just too close. You're too close to it.
Mm-hmm.
So I worked my way through, and I found that some colors, while this colorway is very pleasing to me, it didn't have curb appeal,
mm-hmm.
and I would love it, but it just didn't have the brightness.
Mm-hmm.
And I found with these two, it was very interesting. These are the same three colors with a different color chosen as the main color.
Oh, okay, yep. Mm-hmm.
And one is more striking than the other, which
mm-hmm.
also was very interesting to me. And then certain colors I found got buried or just muddied the waters. This is a beautiful denim blue that's very lovely here on the color card.
Mm-hmm.
But when I started putting it with other colors, it just kind of muddied things.
Right.
So I found that this blue was my friend because it was bright and happy,
mm-hmm.
and it just sparked up things a little bit better,
mm-hmm.
better contrast than the light blue.
Mm-hmm.
Same with this one. This has the pale purple in it,
right.
and the pale purple right here was just not doing anything for my swatches. So that
mm-hmm.
immediately became one that I cast aside and
right.
said no. So I chose to make the tan and black and cream, obviously,
mm-hmm.
and then I went with this glorious piece because, again, it's also
mm-hmm.
unisex.
Mm-hmm.
And notice I have the fringe on that one. So underneath the swatching
yes.
is the finished one, finished scarf.
There we go.
This, again, will not leave my side either because it's just so
okay,
spectacular.
So actually, it shows more.
Yeah, it does.
Like that.
So again, the 280 stitches.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the fringe is interesting also
yes.
because it's not applied afterwards. The fringe is part of the knitting.
Right.
So at the very last row, when you're binding off, I left 10 stitches live at one end and 10 stitches live unbound off at the other end.
So you have loops.
And yeah, I prefer loops than
mm-hmm.
than cut. I'll show you
mm-hmm.
on the swatching. So what happened was you just drop the 10 stitches, and these will not run. It's a misnomer for people to worry that stitches will run. They only run when they get pressure or tension on them. So finished with the bind off, and then come back to my 10 stitches that are loose, and then you unpick.
Mm-hmm.
So each row, remember, was two colors, so each fringe has the equivalent of two colors in them.
Right, right.
Yes. And I preferred the stitches, the fringe looped. These were cut.
Yeah,
and you can see that
unravel.
They start to unravel, and it's a little bit messier finish.
Right.
And so I just decided, no, I'm going to leave loops.
Yeah, no, I like
yeah.
that myself.
There's an occasional one cut because this was a tail.
Right.
And another trick that I learned is if I was changing the balls of yarn, because there's actually 8 balls of yarn in here, 4 of the main color and 2 each of the contrast.
Right.
If I do change the yarn down at this end, then I can bury the tails in the fringe.
There you go.
So just bring them through so that they don't pop out because this will be worn quite a bit and the stitch is kind of loose, so it would pop out otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
So while I was making all of these swatches, it's a little tedious to have that third ball hanging over on the edge, just waiting.
Right.
So I thought, wouldn't it be wonderful to do things like we've done before with the zigzags with the Millie Calori Baby,
mm-hmm.
to do a self-striping yarn in. So we have only two colors, not three.
Love that.
So this was the inspiration for this lovely piece.
Okay.
So I used the same bento because for my swatching, because that's what I had, and I had Barocco send me then a ball of the new colors of Millie Fiori so that it's a self-striper. I brought a swatch along so you can see how the Millie Fiori stripes.
Right.
Is this a good camera angle?
Here we go. Yeah.
Okay.
I'll show
that
right
way.
Side.
So this is how the yarn stripes on its own if you didn't have another color with it. It makes it easier for folks to understand,
mm-hmm.
oh, these yarns are in my stash and the stripes like that, so it
right.
will work. If you had the multicolors that only had a couple of stitches per color, that wouldn't work so well. And the super long gradients that are very popular right now would give a different look from this. I haven't knit
mm-hmm.
one, but I think it also would be stunning.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the longer the stripe, the better on these. So with the striping yarn, I did the same. I started swatching.
Okay.
So I already knew that shade of blue and purple were not really my friend.
I'm just going to do
that. That's fine.
This so that we can really see these.
So aren't these gorgeous? So now, Ginger,
multis.
All I'm doing is color A, color B, color A, color B, color
love
A, color
it.
B. And I'm doing a checkerboard, remember, and it's all garter stitch. So it's the easiest thing going. Drop it in the middle of the row and pick it up. You do not have to reference a pattern or count anything. You're just doing the opposite of what you see.
Okay.
So again, I found that this would be the chosen one because it's that super bright blue. These were the colors of the multicolored yarn,
mm-hmm.
and then these were the colors of the solid.
Right.
And again, swatching helped me. I know that folks are reluctant to swatch, mm-hmm. but in this case, swatching is my friend.
Mm-hmm.
So swatching helped me decide which ones had high curb appeal and which ones,
that one
is just striking.
It is.
Now, another one that I love so much was this beautiful black watch plaid,
mm-hmm.
black on the green, but it's very dark.
Yeah.
And so from a distance, that might be a little tough when you're using it in a store or in a conference.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll save that one for later. Mm-hmm. And then I really, really, really enjoyed this piece. But like the other gray and green and brown one we had, it doesn't have a lot of curb appeal from a distance.
Right.
But I would certainly wear that. It would go
mm-hmm.
with my navy coat and mm-hmm. my gray coat and my black coat.
It's all a matter of your personal
exactly.
preferences, too.
Exactly. So I spent the time doing the swatches just to know better which colors would make me happy, so there
mm-hmm.
wasn't any horror or problems when I was knitting the actual piece, deciding, you know, that buyer's remorse. Oh, no, I didn't pick the right colors. Well,
right.
I already knew what picked the right colors.
Okay.
So would it help? Would you like me to show how I do this?
I would love to see it now that I know that it's not slipping.
It's not slipping. It's so easy.
Yes.
So let's see. So what I brought. So I started the piece last night, and I picked tan and red because, A, that's what I had, and, B, there's enough contrast. And it's not in any of my swatches, which is kind of interesting because it's pretty.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the cast-on edge you can see is my cabled cast-on because it makes a nice loose and prominent edge.
Okay.
And then you can start and understand now how I'm doing this because you're seeing my one stitch floats,
mm-hmm.
aren't you?
Yes.
So if you look on my needles, you'll see it's red, gray, red taupe, red taupe, red taupe, red taupe.
Mm-hmm.
So I will start knitting now and show you, try to knit slowly and show you how this works. So I am a continental knitter. Many of your viewers know what that means. And I have learned how to throw with my right hand, the American.
You have to do that.
Just because it makes it easier for stranding. And
yes.
when we're finished with this, we'll put all the yarn in one hand and show it with one hand.
Okay.
So I'm carrying my predominant color, my main color, in my continental hand because that's the hand I'm most comfortable with.
Right.
And then the awkward hand is the contrast color. And I think what happens here is I get larger floats with my... Yes.
I notice the same thing, too. I get a little tighter with the right hand.
So I knit... it's a checkerboard, remember. So
mm-hmm.
my first stitch is taupe.
Okay.
So I'm going to make my first stitch be red.
Okay.
Now I see a red stitch, so here comes the taupe.
Okay.
Did you follow that?
Okay.
And then here comes red again because all I'm doing is checkerboarding.
Okay.
And I'm trying to be a little bit clammy hands here, but I'm trying to be just my normal tension of loose enough so that these floats show in the back, because they're the right side always, because it's completely reversible. And
right.
with a scarf, you want both sides to look presentable. Yeah. So just red taupe all the way across the row. That's all I'm doing.
So who would have thought that just stranding with garter stitch
would be so
would give
good
you
looking.
This.
You and I have been knitting for combined probably 75 years. Why were we never doing this before? Why were we all those wasted years? We could things that we could have made with this. And you know that I will be exploring this more. So, anyway, let me get across this row so we can show the beginning of it. And I have a couple of other tips to say. And no, we did not speed up the video. This is how I do it. A little slower with that hand. All right. So when I turn the row around, this goes to the don't worry about how many you cast on or you didn't.
Right,
if you didn't
right.
count correctly, it doesn't really matter. So I get to the end of my round. And then I just turn around, and lo and behold, so my stitch first one is tan.
Mm-hmm.
Can you see that?
Mm-hmm.
So the first one's going to be red. I don't have to count anything, and then just go back to the tan.
Okay.
Now, at the knitting convention in Chicago, I had a swatch started so that the consumer could try to knit it just to see if they could do it. Because remember, the knitters have a lower skill level or newer skill level.
Right.
And this looks rather intimidating. So this just looks very intimidating.
Mm-hmm.
So I had a piece. And what was quite interesting to me is to see, everyone doesn't knit at the same tension, you and I know,
right.
to see how my swatch changed over the weekend between the different styles of knitting, between
mm-hmm.
folks who had never held yarn in two hands before
mm-hmm.
or the folks trying it with both colors in one hand.
Right.
So then I learned something as well. So if I was going to carry both colors in one hand, and again, I'm going back to Continental because that's where I'm comfortable, and this steps outside my comfort zone, not using one color in each hand.
Okay.
So the next stitch is taupe, so I'm going to take a red one.
Mm-hmm.
And then the following stitch is red, so I take a taupe one.
Okay.
And then you can just do this way. This requires that you look at your knitting a little bit more so that your video watching or book reading or children watching would suffer.
I'm going to have to give that a try again.
So you can do that.
Right.
So then that looks the same as what I was doing because I'm purposefully trying to be loose enough.
Yeah.
But what somebody did at the show mm-hmm. is she was, this is an example of what not to do. She was doing this, and then she was making sure that she twisted. Like, remember when we do intarsia?
Yeah.
She was twisting the
right,
contrast
right.
stitch and always taking it from below. Let
right.
me get there. And what you ended up getting was the edge of a Latvian mitten, you know, that beautiful twisted
right.
thing,
and that's not
which
what
is
we want.
Not what we want to do.
Okay.
It's starting to twist up on here,
right.
and it was, and she was getting that beautiful, almost half braided edge.
Oh, wow.
So okay. that the life lesson there is not, in this case, not to twist
right.
like we're accustomed to doing, not to twist. Just let them be floats.
Okay. All right.
Isn't that wonderful?
Well, okay,
do you want to try
what
it?
Not to do.
No. Not on camera. Yeah, so
okay.
it's the most beautiful thing, and I envisioned in different gauges of yarns, if someone has a lot of hand dyes in
mm-hmm.
the fingering weight, so that mm-hmm. it would use a number 4 needle. This is up on a number 9. This is a beautiful
right.
thing to jump to a 9 and get things done quickly.
Yes.
But
yes.
any gauge of yarn, I would encourage swatching so that you can see how your colors will play out on your piece and decide, well, maybe that needs a contrast or doesn't need a contrast,
okay.
Or maybe these colors just don't work, like my denim blue just did not work. The beautiful scarf, the tan one,
mm-hmm.
it would add another level of complication, but what I would really love on this is every inch, two rows that carry this along, the red, because that tartan plaid has a little bit of red
right,
in
just
it.
A little bit,
so that
yeah.
would make that amazing, and that's not a color that you could carry up the edge. You would
right.
just put the
just throw that
contrast row in every inch or so, just put
right.
that one in a little bit, and then cut that and weave it in later.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe that would need fringe because you're weaving it in.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, that is, we're getting close to our time here.
Already?
I know.
We just got started.
I told you it goes by so quickly. The other thing, I just want to make a comment about this is, because you can't feel this.
The fabric is so smooshy.
It is. It's smooshy.
Smooshy,
yes.
Yeah.
It feels almost thermal-like.
Yes.
It's light, but it's very, It's not dense.
Someone
I suppose
at the
if
show
you knit tighter,
it was
it would be
double
dense.
Knitting, and it's not
yeah,
double knitting
no,
either.
No,
but
so it's
yes,
warm.
It's very smooshy. I was very excited. If anyone gets a chance to be in a knit shop that has a sample of this, go up and touch it.
Yeah,
that's where I had said baby blankets.
Right.
This is
right.
an ultimate baby blanket. It could be a cowl. Do it flat and then seam it,
mm-hmm.
Or maybe mm-hmm. do some kind of a crochet or decorative for the seam so that it
right.
shows that it's pretty on purpose.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, you can be sure that this is going to be in my shop. I am going to get started on a sample of this right away.
Oh, one thing I should mention. I'm going to give it up, my Ravelry ID.
Oh, yes, yes.
Because I made some changes to the original pattern.
Okay.
And then to see the images, I added a little bit of extra yarn. They needed 700 yards. I used 800. I
okay.
abhor extras. So I made sure all the balls ran out,
okay.
and I changed the needle size. I made some changes. And so on the notes, you know how on Ravelry, when you see a project, you have to scroll down to see the notes?
Yes.
On all of my projects, the notes are the most important thing. They should be at the top.
Yeah.
But I encourage everybody to scroll. So on Ravelry, the easiest way to find me is actually my Ravelry personal ID page.
Mm-hmm.
And my name, you know, is Rentgen, but we'll spell that for your viewers.
Okay.
It's a unit measure of X-ray. So
I
scientists will know.
Where did this come from?
Dr. Rentgen discovered X-rays. We didn't even get into science today.
Oh.
So it's spelled R-O-E-N-T-G-E-N. He was a German scientist.
Okay.
So it's pronounced Rentgen.
Okay.
That goes to my engineering days where the name came from.
Okay.
But all of these projects are shown there on my project page with images and then the yarns that I used exactly and then the notes, the important notes.
Okay.
Yes, very
okay.
important.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad. Thank you so
this
much.
This was so much fun.
It was, and I can't wait to have you back again to show us what else that you come
what's
up
on
with.
My needles next.
Yes, it's on your needles next. Well, I want to thank everybody for joining us today for another episode of Focus on Fiber Arts, and hope to see you again. And I want to thank Andra one more time for being here. So I hope that this has inspired you to get this on your needles, and. You know that I'll be joining you very soon, too. So thank you, and make sure that you keep a focus on fiber. See you soon.
Funding for Simsbury Community Television is provided in part by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.